hope everyone's having a great day. In today's video, which is the seventh in the series about understanding the Panasonic Lumix FZ150 camera, we're going to start looking at using the flash facility. We're going to be looking at setting up the internal flash of the camera, and then more importantly, looking at how to use external flash units, such as those I've got on the table here, to really develop your flash photography using the FZ150 camera. With the external flash units, you can really start to use your imagination. And I'll show you some work I did today using the external flash. The day was very overcast, no sun at all, and it was struggling to get exposures of more than 1/60th at f3.5. But by using the pocket flash, I've been able to extend that to f8 to get some depth of field needed in close-up photography. Okay, so let's get started. I'll show you the internal flash menu first, and then we'll look at how to set up the external flash. We'll now look at using flash in the intelligent auto mode. And really, in the intelligent auto mode, you're giving control to the camera of all the flash facilities, so it will determine whether it's going to use flash or not. You can't actually force it to fire flash if the camera doesn't believe that you need flash in this situation. In the intelligent auto mode, the working range is in the wide angle position between 0.3 and 9.5 meters, so that's about a foot to 30 feet. And in the telephoto mode, it's a meter to 5.1 meter, so that's about 3 foot to 16 feet. If you engage the flash by releasing the button which says open on the top of the camera, the flash will open and the camera will then charge the flash circuitry. If the camera is going to use flash, when you half press the shutter button, the lightning symbol plus the intelligent auto will actually turn red. So if I half press the shutter button now, the camera has determined that it doesn't need flash. There's actually sufficient light that the camera can use without engaging flash. If you were to press the shutter in a darker environment, the symbol would change red and the flash would be enabled. It's only when you use the semi-manual modes that you have full control over the flash in terms of whether you want it on and what power to use. Let's now look at flash in the other shooting modes, and to begin with we'll start to look at flash in the AE mode, or the programmed auto, which is accessed by turning the top control dial to the P position. And I have the flash set up for automatic at the moment, so it's mimicking what would happen in the intelligent auto mode. So again, if the camera thinks there's enough light, it won't fire the flash. So if I half press the shutter button, again, the flash symbol hasn't turned red, so if I take the picture, it isn't going to use flash. If I wanted to force flash on, then we have to go back into the menu, and it's on page 4, and then cursor down to flash, and then across to the right to access the options. So to change from automatic flash to force flash on, we need to cursor down to the third option, which is the forced flash on symbol. So when we do that, the camera will fire irrespective of the amount of light that's reaching the scene at the moment. So now if I half press the shutter button, you notice that the flash symbol turns red, and that will mean that it will fire when I press the shutter button. You can use this to balance the flash to the natural lighting condition. So for example, if you wanted to balance the flash exposure to daylight, if you were taking a portrait outside, then you can use the flash power to vary that, and we can change the flash power by use of the flash control. To access flash control, it's a triple press of the plus minus key, and that varies the flash power from 2 stops under to 2 stops over. So if you are using flash in the P mode and you find your flash pictures are turning out consistently underexposed or consistently overexposed, you can apply that exposure value change to control the amount of flash power. So for example, if my flash pictures always tended to be overexposed, then if we go into the EV flash control, then we could dial back the flash power to say 1 EV, and that will darken all the pictures. In the programmed auto mode, the P mode, the camera is again looking at the amount of illumination on the scene and will determine whether it wants to fire flash or not. So in this situation, if I half press the shutter button, the camera will determine whether there's enough light or not. And in this case, the flash icon has stayed white, so in this situation, there's enough light and the camera determines that we don't need to use flash. If I wanted to actually force it to take flash, then I use the program shift facility to close down the aperture. So remember, you half press the shutter button to enable the rectangle around the aperture and shutter, and I'm going to change the aperture to something like f5.6. So now as I've changed to f5.6, when I half press the shutter button, the camera's determined there isn't enough light and is going to engage flash. So now when I take the photograph, the camera will fire the flash. Let's now look at taking portraits or group shots with the camera in the P mode, and we want to engage the red eye reduction. So to do that, we go back into the flash menu, which is on page 4, and we change it to the automatic mode with red eye reduction. So this is a pre-flash, which then forces the pupil to close so that when the main flash fires, the amount of reflected light from the back of the eye, the blood vessels at the back of the eye, are reduced, so we don't get this characteristic red eye result. So when we take the picture now, the camera will fire a pre-flash followed by the main flash. So there's a pre-flash followed by the main flash. There is an additional feature within the camera to actually apply software red eye reduction as well as the primary flash. And that is a facility which looks for a portrait mode and looks for eyes in that portrait. And if there is any red in the eye, it makes those a neutral colour. And to do that red eye reduction in software, you need to enable it in the menu. So if we go into the menu, and it's on the next page, and it's called red eye removal, and it's the one with a little paintbrush which turns on this facility when you're in the flash mode. So you can now see the flash symbol has changed to automatic with the software red eye reduction. So if there is any residual red eye in the picture, when the camera processes that, it will actually reduce the red eye. So that's a good feature to turn on if you are taking group pictures where the people which are directly on access to the lens are more likely to see red eye than the extreme edges. So this will actually reduce the red eye in those people. The final option you can actually use in flash is what's called slow sync, and it's useful if you're taking portraits in twilight or night time and you want the camera to actually expose the background to a reasonable degree of exposure and then fire the flash to give a perfectly exposed flash. So we access that with the slow shutter flash symbol, and again, if you are using the software red eye reduction, the icon will change to the paintbrush with the red eye as well. So in this mode, when we take the picture, the camera will expose for the scene in the background and then we'll fire the flash with the correct exposure. It is recommended when you're taking flash photos to remove the lens hood, as under certain situations the actual lens hood can throw a shadow onto the subject. 2. Let's now look at attaching an external flash unit to the FZ150. Panasonic do a range of dedicated flash guns for the FZ150, however these tend to be quite expensive. I decided to use the cheaper option of using an existing flash unit, which isn't TTL, so the camera can't control the flash, but I can control the flash output power by dialing down the manual control of the flash gun. Once you install a flash gun on top of the hot shoe of the camera, the flash icon will go from no flash to a flash symbol. So as I install my flash unit on the top, you can now see that the flash icon has gone from no flash to flash enabled. With a non-dedicated flash unit attached to the camera, if we go into the flash menu, the only options we have are to turn the flash on or off, and we don't get the option to change the flash output power. To control the flash exposure, then you have to use your flash gun in the manual mode, and you can vary the power. Here I've got an 1/8 power, or a 1/16 power, a 32nd, or a 64th, or full power. So you can judge the exposure by looking at the image on the back of the camera, and if it's too bright, just dial down the manual exposure, and if it's too dark, increase it. So again, if you're using the flash gun in a bounce flash mode, where you're pointing the flash head towards the ceiling to get some softer light, then the camera won't know you're doing that, so you'll have to manually compensate by changing your flash power setting. So using the external flash gun does give you the advantage that the flash is slightly higher than the internal flash unit, and that will help to reduce some of the red eye. But to get better effects from your external flash, it's better if you try and take the flash unit off camera, either onto a flash bracket or handheld, to give you better control. Let's first of all look at installing the flash on a flash bracket and attaching the flash bracket to the camera. So now I've mounted the flash gun on a flash bracket which is attached to the camera, but now we have to find some way of connecting the hot shoe of the camera to the flash unit itself. Older flash units used to have a protocomper shutter cable, and that was the coaxial socket. So if your flash unit has a coaxial socket on the side of it, then you can use a hot shoe to PC cable adapter, which will help you connect the two units together. So you can either connect the flash to the hot shoe adapter with a straight cable or with a curly cable, depending on what you have. So if your flash unit doesn't have a PC socket on it, then you'll need a PC to hot shoe adapter on the flash unit, and a hot shoe to PC adapter to enable you to use an external cable. So it's then a case of connecting the hot shoe on the flash adapter to the hot shoe on the camera. Instead of using two hot shoe adapters, you can buy these dedicated extension cables. So this is a multi-format one, which will connect to Canon or Nikon cameras. It's got multi-point contacts. But we're really only interested in firing the centre pin and ground pin for the camera setup. So these will work quite well with an external flash unit, even if it's not completely dedicated to your camera. So now I have the hot shoe of the multi-connector on the camera and the hot shoe adapter to the flash unit connected to the flash itself. And now we have connection between the camera and the flash unit. So when we fire the shutter, the flash will fire. So that gives us a bit better control by having the flash off the camera axis, and that will actually reduce the amount of red eye. I quite often use the flash unit and the extension cable without the flash bracket, and I just manually hold the flash unit above my head to control the angle at which the flash is firing towards the subject. Let's now look at connecting this wirelessly to the camera, as sometimes the coil cable can get in the way and limits you to just a few feet between yourself and the flash unit. To use the wireless flash facility, you'll need a transmitter and a receiver unit. These are manufactured by Trust, but they are available on eBay from several manufacturers, and they all look identical, so they're probably produced by the same company in China, but just given different names. They are four channel, so you can set different channels if you are working alongside someone else that's also using a wireless trigger. You can actually use different independent channels. So providing you match the transmitter and the receivers of the same channel, the range is supposed to be something like about 150 feet outside, but I haven't actually verified that. To use the system, we mount the transmitter on top of the camera and we use the receiver to fire the flash unit. With the system enabled, we have the transmitter on the hot shoe of the camera and we have the receiver fastened to the flash unit. So when the camera fires, it will send a wireless signal from the transmitter, which the receiver picks up and fires the flash. So if I fire the flash now, the transmitter will trigger the camera flash unit. So now that gives us total flexibility between where the camera is positioned and where the flash is positioned. So you can set the flash up on another tripod to the side of the subject or to the back of the subject. And if you've got more than one flash receiver that's set to the same channel, then you can have a multi-flash setup quite easily within your studio or home setup. There is another method of triggering your external flash unit using the internal flash unit of the camera. Because the flash of the camera uses a pre-flash, then the optical trigger that you use has to be intelligent enough to know that there's going to be a second flash, and that's the one that should fire the main flash unit. This particular unit has the facility to change between one pre-flash and five pre-flashes, so you can actually set it up to fire on the second flash from the camera. These are available again on eBay from several of the manufacturers in China, and they work quite well. These older optical triggers, which were just basically photocells, were okay when cameras just had one flash, but now we get the pre-flash issue, these would fire on the pre-flash and you would miss the main flash event. So unfortunately, these optical triggers are no longer valid. However, you can use the optical trigger if you've got a wireless remote setup, because the wireless only fires once and then these slave flash units will pick up the single flash and fire off any subsequent flash units attached to the optical slave. So here's some examples of the wireless flash unit in operation. I was trying to take some photographs of the crocus with a little bit of rain that had fallen on them, and the lighting was pretty poor. I could only get 1/60th of a second at f3.2 at ISO 100, so it did mean that I had to use flash to get an exposure of f8. By using the manual power control of the flash gun and varying the distance to the subject, I could actually get the right exposure. And by use of these flash diffusers, you can actually give yourself a softer light so as that eliminates some of the harsh shadows by just using the open flash unit itself. So these just clip on the front of the flash unit and give you a much softer light, as I'll show you in this photograph now. If you want to use external flash guns, there's a plethora of flash units available on eBay, but what you have to be careful of is what's called the trigger voltage, and that is the voltage between the tip of the flash unit and the ground terminal. On some of the early flash units, the trigger voltage was actually derived directly from the trigger coil in the flash unit and could have been up to 300 volts. The internal circuitry of your FZ150 is only enabled for very low voltage. You want to connect one of these older high voltage triggering units to the hot shoe of your FZ150, you will probably fry the internal thyristor of the FZ150. So it's better to, if you are going to buy one of these units, is to consult the flash trigger voltage from one of the flash strobe sites, and I'll try and put a link of that into the video, and you can actually verify whether the trigger voltage is low enough so you can use it on the FZ150. So for example, I purchased this Minolta 4000 AF flash unit. It's a dedicated unit for the old Minolta cameras, but has a hot shoe accessory which can fit onto the FZ100, and the trigger voltage is only about 6 volts for this unit, so it's ideal. And this gun has a very high guide number, so it's ideal for acting as a main light for studio work. One of the other options you can use with these very high power flash guns is to use one of these white nylon umbrellas, and actually you can get the attachment to fit the flash to the brolly handle, and you fire the flash unit into the brolly to give you a reflective situation, or you can fire through the brolly at your subject, and that gives you a much more diffuse light. These brollies are available freely on eBay and are only a few pounds. So this would be my preferred flash setup, using a wireless transmitter receiver combination with an external flash unit, one that's got manual control of the flash power, so you can actually vary the intensity of the light source, so you can get it further back so as to create softer shadows. So for example, if you want to photograph insects such as butterflies, these are an ideal combination, as it gives you that freedom of movement and a high enough light source to give you the F8 that you would need to get the maximum depth of field. If you wanted to soften the internal flash, then here's a simple solution. It's just some kitchen paper, and I've just secured that with a small elastic band around the flash head. So when the flash fires, it's diffused slightly by the paper towel. Obviously, increase your flash exposure, the EV compensation, maybe +1 or +2 stops, to compensate for the reduced flash power. And this will give you a much more pleasing shadow effect rather than the harsh shadows created by the open flash unit itself. If you are using the internal flash in the intelligent auto mode, if the camera detects that you are taking a portrait, it automatically switches in the portrait photo style. And in the portrait photo style, it actually softens the skin, so it actually reduces the resolution, or it applies some sort of blur algorithm. And it also lowers the contrast. So when you actually take a photograph, you might notice that the actual contrast is very low in the resulting image. So you might have to post-process that to get the situation looking better. If you are in the P mode, or any of the manual shooting modes, then obviously the camera doesn't find the portrait mode, so it doesn't switch into the portrait mode with the reduced contrast. And you can see in these two examples, here I am taking a self-portrait in the intelligent auto mode, and the camera selected portrait mode, and it's resulted in quite a flat image. But once I switched over to the programmed auto mode and set the right exposure for the distance of the flash unit to the subject, the resulting picture isn't as soft and is more defined. If you wanted to soften that down a little bit, then you can actually put a couple of sheets of tissue paper over the flash unit and then dial in a little bit more flash exposure to compensate for it. So that's the end of this video about understanding flash with the FZ150. I have a previous video which looked at flash with the FZ100. So a lot of that stuff is relevant to today's video, if you want to look at this link here and just have a look at the other facilities you can use with external flash. So there's just one more video in this series, which is looking at the advanced features of the camera, how to get better detail in your pictures, and also how to use the white balance to be able to get better colour rendering in your photography. Okay, so that's it for now, and I hope to see you in the next video. Thanks for watching. Bye now.